Pentecost, along with Christmas and Easter, rank as one of the three most important days in the church calendar. The first two of these, Christmas and Easter, celebrate the birth and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But it is in the third one, Pentecost, where we really get involved. For it marks the sending of the Holy Spirit upon the church, the baptism of many people that day, and it gives us the imperative to become the body of Christ on this earth and to continue the church throughout all the ages. On this day, we recall the coming down of the Holy Spirit on the people of first century Jerusalem and the uniting of many tongues and ethnic origins. Now, since my retirement, my Episcopal visits come mostly in off years. The canons of the church require that the bishop or one of his suffragans or assistants visit every church in the diocese each year. However, with 70 plus churches, Bishop Breidenthal cannot be at every church every year. So he has asked that Bishop Nettie Rivera, retired bishop living in Cincinnati, and I, now retired living in Hilliard, assist him by visiting the churches that he isn't able to make it to in a year. However, I realize that this is my second visit to you recently, because every now and then the schedule works in such a way that it becomes 2 years before he can come. And so I was glad to snatch up this Pentecost day and be with you. I would like to be in a church, an exciting church, particularly a church with great music, and I knew we couldn't beat the music that is here at St. Mark's. The other reason that I'm glad to be here today is that only a bishop can bless an altar. And so when Paul called and said that the altar in the chapel over to the back of the nave had a new altar, that chapel had a new altar, he asked if I would be willing to bless it, and I was happy to do that, and hope you all could hear the blessing, even though we couldn't all get in there. Although we didn't hear it in the lesson from Acts that was read today, if you've read on, you'll hear that Luke reports that following the action that we heard read about, some 3,000 people presented themselves to Jesus to be to the apostles, to the disciples, to be baptized on that day. After Jesus had ascended into heaven, he said to the apostles, "I'll send you my Spirit. The Spirit that has been there since the beginning of time will come in a new and magnificent way, and that Spirit will inspire people to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ." This event, plus the Great Commission that Jesus gave to his disciples to go forth and baptize all nations, are the sum total of the Pentecost event. I'm sure that both the coming of the Spirit on that day and the Great Commission were in the minds of the early church leaders. Now, some 20 centuries later, those words still ring true. "Go, make disciples of all people. Baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of time." Simply stated, this says that we have seen God in Jesus, we have received Jesus and the Holy Spirit in baptism, and we have been promised that God in Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, will abide with us and be with us always. My brothers and sisters, we cannot rest until that message is known by every person. Every person in the world who does not yet know Jesus should be introduced to him through contact with those of us who are Christians. As Christians, it's imperative that this message be the driving force of our life. We have a new presiding bishop in the Episcopal Church, and if you haven't heard him, if you have an opportunity to hear him preach, be sure and do so, or check out the website, which reproduces a lot of his sermons. He's the most dynamic and evangelical preacher I think I've ever heard. And his message is clear. We are Jesus people, and we must never be afraid to proclaim that. As Jesus people, we go forth to bring the message of love and reconciliation that he brought to this earth, so that people through us may come to know Jesus. For many years, you here at St. Mark's have had excellent directors and dynamic lay leaders. You have grown in spirit, although there is some sadness as I look out and realize over the 23 years that I've been here, the number of your lay leaders that have now gone to greater glory. And yet they're still here as part of the communion of saints. And others of you have moved in and are succeeding them. This is a joy-filled and uplifting congregation. And it's one that all throughout my ministry I have looked forward to coming to be part of. In most strong parishes filled with people, however, there are sometimes differing opinions. I doubt that's ever the case at St. Mark's, but most of the churches I visit, every now and then people get into a disagreement. Sometimes over faith, matters of faith, sometimes over matters of practice, sometimes over which drawer to put the spatulas in the kitchen. No fear, though. Well, that's also a mark of your strength. Because you see, one of the earmarks of the Episcopal Church is that it encourages people to study, to think, to make up their own minds, and at times to disagree. We're not a cookie-cutter church in which everyone must always agree with everything. Pentecost, with its report of the coming together of people of many different backgrounds, many different tongues, many different origins and languages, provide for us a reminder of just how diverse the church is and gives us the model for how we should be too. It is your first call as people baptized in the Spirit to be evangelical minded. And in this task, in spite of the differences that may exist among you, it's vital that you keep your eye on the prize, which comes from knowing that the mission of the church is spreading the love of Jesus Christ. The love that Jesus brought to this earth is now kept alive through our ministry on this earth as part of his body. Now, one of the great things about this particular Feast of Pentecost is we have a baptism. Very historic for you to come. I asked Paul where the other 2,999 were, but he said that they're waiting until next Pentecost. Not only will we be able to share in the joy of your baptism, but also all of us will renew our own baptismal vows. As we do, we must not lose the focus of our primary covenant to bring people to Jesus Christ, to become recommitted in our calling to redeem the world for Christ. You know, as we put on the TV or read the papers today and listen to the verbal bickering and that's going on in the political world, or whenever we turn on the news or pick up the paper and see the world running amok with shootings almost every day in the city, with love sometimes being treated as a recreational activity rather than a way of life, with instances of road rage escalating to violence, with blacks and whites attacking each other, with community leaders sometimes being accused of graft or misconduct, we might think that the values that Jesus brought into this world have gotten lost in the shuffle. Well, there's never been a time more ripe than right now to return to and renew our commitment to the promises made in our baptism to provide a different way of living. Ever since that day on Pentecost long ago, baptism has been the action by which we proclaim our allegiance to Jesus Christ. Now, young Josephine will not be able to answer the questions for herself today, but her parents and her godparents and all of us who are part of her larger family will answer in her behalf and with a commitment to teach her what we are promising. And so, just before we move to the baptism, let me review with you what those promises are so that when we make them as part of the service, they will have a little more meaning. First of all, we promise to continue the apostles' teaching and fellowship and the breaking of the bread. Josephine is not just baptized into her family or even into one church, but rather into the whole of Christianity. And so, wherever you may be, wherever any of us may be at any given time, seek out a fellowship. Participate in the in the prayers and the breaking of the bread. And particularly here at St. Mark's, you have a beautiful church. There is no reason in the world why you shouldn't be proud to reach out to those around you and invite them to come and share in this fellowship here. Second promise, persevere in resisting evil. And whenever we sin, repent and return to the Lord. As I pointed out in that litany of things earlier, evil is still very much alive in this world today. Now, most of us probably will never murder someone, but the lure of secular materialism and of making bad choices always is hovering there. That's certainly a danger for our children. The church provides, however, a better way to live. The church provides a model for living. And even though, because we're human, we sometimes miss the mark, the church also reminds us that if we are truly repentant, we will receive God's forgiveness and can go on stronger. Number three, proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ. This is my favorite one. Now, by that I don't mean you should all become street preachers and go out and preach to people, but rather, there's another way we can communicate the message of Jesus, by the way we live our lives. The example that we live is gained from the way that Jesus lived and taught. And when people see how we live, they come to know Jesus. Living with a positive attitude, confident that by the help of the Holy Spirit, we can overcome any temptation. These are examples of goodness that really are what proclaiming the good news is all about. Hopefully, when people will look at you, they'll say, well, there's a person who obviously has some joy in living. I want to find out more on what empowers them. And so, by word and example, you have then spread the good news of God in Christ. The last two promises I'll sort of look at together. They are to seek and serve Christ in all persons, and to strive for justice and peace and respect the dignity of every human being. We are a peace-loving church. We are a church that holds that as a primary tenet. The promises that we make are promises to try to create a more peaceful world than might otherwise be. You know, when we look at every person we meet and see in them Jesus Christ himself, because all of us are part of the incarnation, all of us are a reflection of Jesus. When we see in that other person Jesus, then it's hard to ever look down on them, or to be judgmental, or to disdain their life or their lifestyle. We may be tempted, but we would resist using them for our own means, because we know that to do that to them would also be to do that to Jesus. How can we bring people to Jesus for whom we have no respect? But if we see in Jesus them, then our respect is ongoing. On the other hand, when we disagree with people and still love them, we're modeling Jesus' love, who continued to reach out to people and offer them his love and forgiveness. People will be drawn to a community where that goes on, and the community will be enriched by the diversity that we have within it. And so, in closing, if we do all this, we cannot fail. Hopefully on this Feast of the Pentecost in the year 2017, you'll be able to feel the power of Jesus' Great Commission. And as we pour water on Josephine and anoint her with the sign of the cross, feel the action of the Holy Spirit in that sacrament, and also feel the gift of the Holy Spirit that all of us have received. Reach deep down within your soul. Think of the Spirit that was sent to the disciples on that first Pentecost as being very present here today. If you do this, and if you listen carefully, then you just might hear the voice of Jesus saying, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. Amen.